gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother, and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Oh, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry.
And so now it's 22 days since LaMelo was killed in Biloxi. And still no answers either from the district attorney or from the Biloxi PD. Ro, you have reached out to the district attorneys, and the response?
No response.
Question we had was simply this, DA Parker, is whether or not the investigation has been turned over to you. You know, at some point, it would stand to reason that there should be some response here. Now, and I'll tell you why, ladies and gentlemen. There's been many, many other cases similar where the agencies were far more forthcoming. You know, you're able to do, you can do a press release. Here is where we are. So it's 22 days now that the four-month-old who has been buried with his mother, we still have no answers, and it's not going to go away until we get answers, I assure you of that. Many of you have asked me to pursue sending it to national news. I don't have to send it to national news. If national news is interested, then they will reach out and do it. But I don't doubt that if, in fact, I make some phone calls, things can happen. Let me make this very clear to you. See, I'm not of the opinion that media gets things done. Some of you have been convinced of that, and maybe you are convinced of that when you watch Eye of the Prize about those infamous days when the media showed Selma, showed Montgomery, and the brutality. I got you. And you're thinking the media, CBS, ABC, all of them, they were the reasons why something was done, because they brought it to light. Well, you're wrong. The reason why something was done was because individuals and organizations got together to force that hand politically. NAACP, SCLC, SNCC, even the Black Panther Party for Defense, even the Blackstone Rangers, Deacons for Defense in Bogalusa, Louisiana. It was the concerted effort of African-American organizations that got things done. Media doesn't do anything but report. I want to make sure you understand that. You guys need to back off of this blame the media kind of BS. Oh, Rip Daniels won't let it go. Well, no, I won't let it go, because this is a question regarding LaMelo that needs to be answered. How do you fire 34 shots into an automobile where you know there is an infant? Come on. Just for the sake of getting your man, getting the captor, you kill the hostage? Come on. Not that that happened. But we don't know. Under no circumstances should have been shots. But the media is doing absolutely positively nothing. They did nothing to the impeached Donald John. They did nothing to Jimmy Carter. They did nothing to Richard Nixon. That's where all this came from. And they did nothing to Ronald Reagan, who also blamed the media. Blame the messenger. All they do is rip and read. But the truth is that now we have reached a point where you've got medias with an agenda, like the Dog Network. And I do believe in sometimes that MSNBC, I don't watch MSNBC. I know many of you try to get me to watch. I don't know the commentator. I can't think of her name. What's her name?
Rachel Maddow.
Yeah. I mean, I've seen some of the things, some of her quotes and all, but I don't watch commentary typically because I don't want to be influenced by it. Because I'm in the commentation business, you know what I mean? I watch all kinds of news, though. I think CNN is also influenced. I think sometimes they just get stuck on one situation, one little piece of news, and just wear it out. Just to fill space for 24 hours. I guess it's difficult for them. Then they start interviewing each other.
You didn't have the travel shows. I think they've all used the guise of a news network to impart commentary.
But tell you when to turn it off. You turn it off when you find them interviewing each other. Well, let's just bring in Jay Tapper to see what he thinks about it. Who cares? He's not a newsmaker. He's a reporter. Well, I think it's blah, 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 blah. Yeah, it's time to turn it off. Same thing when you're watching the Dog Network. You know, they want to bring up some other commentary. The four or the five or whoever it is. You know, I don't watch that crap. Those are just opinions. You know what I mean? But the media is doing absolutely positively nothing. Ladies and gentlemen, if anything, the media is being disingenuous. You need to cover it all. You need to separate what's news and then what's commentary. And I really think it's time to do that. What I'm doing right now is commentary. The news is that a baby was killed. That's the news. The news is we don't know how. We do know when. We do have video of the circumstances. We don't know the details. We don't know who shot the Lamello. That's the news. Commentary now is, I don't know. For those of you who are blaming Rip Daniels and take great delight in doing that, I can handle it. Believe me, I have a whole lot of associates even there at Biloxi PD who are in fact associates. Some are friends. They don't have a problem. They don't. They get it. There are law enforcement officers who understand and abide by the standards and what's expected of them as lawmen. Not every police officer or true state trooper fired on that car. There's a finite number of individuals from Gulfport and from the deputy's office, from the sheriff's office, and from the state troopers. Simple as that. All right, boy, we got a lot to cover. Short period of time here, folks. Family's everything, and I've got to go there. I want to talk about the 74 that marched on Jackson. I want to get to that, and then the grand jury now that's now been impaneled for criminal charges potentially against Donald John and his entire mob. But you guys will not let this Hancock County thing go, and oh, man, it's like, you know. You know, I am no therapist. I am no therapist. I'm a lowly father now, grandfather, who feels that he has been successful in being that because I got my sons out of the house and my daughter. Look folks, I'm going to tell you, it's as simple as that. I don't know where you parents have gotten off from thinking that somehow or another you know... It's from cradle to grave when it comes down to your baby. There ain't no damn baby. You're a grown-ass man, a woman. At some point, I know, Mom, you know, you carried them for 9 months and you think you're going to carry them for until they're 57. And then some of your children act like it still. Mama, Mama, my dear. I'm not that kind of father. I was never Mama's boy. You know, I was my daddy's bundle of joy. I don't mind telling you. I really was. I loved working with my daddy from the time I began to walk. And talk and tell him what he wasn't supposed to do. But I'm going to try to go through this, and I'm going to allow you to go ahead and call me and go up one side, down the other. I've got some emails from you guys regarding my response to Hancock County and their little old middle school yearbook.
And I'm going to try to help.
God. The expert, really, you?
Good morning, Rip. How are you?
What does it matter? I'm afraid to say how I am to you, because I know you're just going to analyze the whole thing.
And if you are in a negative space, I'm going to try to help you get back to
home. I'm not going to lay down on no couch, I can tell you that.
It's not necessary.
God, why did I do this? So, in case you're not aware, and it's still sketchy for me, it is my understanding that there was a yearbook. The yearbook was put together by the students. What are the ages we're talking? 13 to what, 14? 13, 14, 12, 13, 14. It's middle school. These are not even ninth graders. These are eighth graders. When did they start doing this anyway? You normally didn't wait. You did a yearbook for when you're in your, you know, high school, senior year or something. So the yearbook makes its way around, right? And the students had a sponsor, which is a teacher, and the teacher oversees all of this to make sure they're doing proper subject-verb agreement and that it's not anything shady going on. Now, some of you parents want to line up. That's fine. And let me know where I explained this wrong, because I tell you, it's just, I don't know whether this was a virtual book. There is a real book that young people paid for.
Yes.
And this book made its way around, I guess, with pictures and so forth of all the little students. And then there was, some sections, I assume, here. And I'm just looking at what someone has sent me. I don't have the book in front of me. There was some parts of the book that asked them rather strange questions, or I guess you can call them questions, huh, Ro? I mean, you're on top of this better than I am.
Yeah.
The questions in the book are basically ask kids to name their least favorite friend.
Right.
And to name a friend they wouldn't invite to spring break.
Yeah, who they don't deal with.
And so... And is it like, I asked yesterday, was it like fill in the blank? But what I'm understanding is that they actually, that day, meaning the authors of the book, actually had screenshots in the book?
Well, printed the names in the book.
So they printed the names of whom?
Whoever the student's named as the...
So are they printing the name of the student
who
wrote it as well? Yeah.
Yes.
So the student who wrote it and the name of the student that they're saying who would not be invited for spring break. And some of you see this as bullying. And I'm on the record yesterday saying, come on, really? Do I think there's coddling? Yes. Do I think there's bullying? Oh, absolutely. It's always been bullying. It's part of growing up. But there, I said it. I know there's a lot of you guys want to say it. It's part of growing up. It's part of growing up. Mom, Dad, get out of children's business. This is what they do. Your task is to teach your child how to deal with that. With bullying. I mean, that's what survival is all about. Why? Do you really have to teach the world? No, teach your child that the world will change because they are your bundle of joy. This brings me to this email. Rip, your indifference about this situation really alarms me. I thought that you were all about family, but it seems as though you are preoccupied with trying to compare everybody's life with your own. Everybody is not like you. I know that. I know that. We are out here in a different kind of world where children are committing suicide on a daily basis, and you seem to be not sympathetic, empathetic, or for that matter, you seem to be more dismissive. I'm very disappointed. I am hopeful that you will see it differently, especially when it comes to your grandchildren. What if one of your grandchildren was in the book? How would you handle it? All right, okay, put it on my Facebook page.
What it is?
Give me one of these questions. They have several in here. I don't think the spring break question.
Have you ever avoided a friend?
Would you like to spike with a volleyball? How about that one? How about this one?
Which friend would you not invite on spring break? Have you ever avoided a friend?
Have you ever avoided a friend and you named a friend? I don't know. Give me a one that's worse than that. Come on, is that all they're working with? The friend I would not bring is the quiet, boring one, and they gave a name. So this is how they I see here where some of the names are on there.
Of who they named and then who wrote it too, right?
Yeah, Lillian. I'm not going to give the last name, not that it makes a difference. I don't want to have some parent of the Lillian calling me and I'll be dismissive. I just hang up the phone.
And dismiss them?
Yes. I mean, folks, come on. We got to teach our children how to be strong in this world. Come on, don't we have to teach them how to be strong in this world? How to avoid some people? Ignore some people? Defend themselves against some people? Do sticks and stones may break my bones and words will never hurt? Does it work anymore? Did you hear that when you were in school, bro?
Oh, yeah. A lot.
Did you use it?
Yeah, I had to.
Your mom was a school teacher. How would she handle this? I know she's listening, but...
Hey, Mom. Which part?
Well, I mean, in other words,
as a teacher or as a parent?
I guarantee you she would not have allowed this annual to go out this way, I'm sure.
Yeah, no, I think I'm fairly confident if she had caught wind of this, she'd cut it off at the pass. But if it had gotten out, I think that she'd probably be along the same lines as you.
So here is the page I'm looking at. Invite on spring break. And it has, number one, my friend Eli says he doesn't like things that I like. I'm just looking at first names here. Jayla, since she is full of herself. So this is what they're saying.
This is what the students are saying about the other students, yeah. In print, in the yearbook.
And so the assumption is that the names in this book, rather than those kids going, oh yeah, they got, look, my name's in the book, they'd go, huh, why won't you invite me? I'm trying not to be dismissive, but all the things that's happening in the world, you've got this.
Hey, this is their world, Rip.
Well, it's their world, and we're making a fuss about it. And what it's telling me, and what my mom would tell me, and what I tell my children would be, well, now you know who not to play with. Oh, don't worry about it. You didn't like them anyway. Why can't they like me? Well, primarily because, you know, they envy you. Usually that's the reason.
Yeah.
I was not allowed, ladies and gentlemen, to feel sorry for myself as I waited for the bus, that school bus, and kids were singing 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate. You want to talk about bullying? Mom, I'm going to go through the 6 or 7, 8 other emails. Let me just tell you what world I came from. All right. Here's my word. Let's see, 8th grade, East Junior High. Coming out of the trailer, my mom's sitting there in the door, waiting for the school bus. I was encouraged because my oldest sister was in the first integrating class. They integrated first in Gulfport, Mississippi. They integrated the 12th grade and the first grade. And African-American parents were tasked with trying to decide what Negroes were going to go. They built it as school choice. This is the way, I think his name is Rigby, was the superintendent. You gotta understand, ladies and gentlemen, when Mississippi was forced to desegregate, the segregationists were still in charge of the school system. You know, these were the same ones who thought separate but equal was okay. They didn't fire any of the superintendents. They didn't fire any of the white segregationist redneck teachers. They were still there. Ultimately, they got to just shutting down all the quote-unquote black schools. But I digress. I'm just giving you some background on where I came from and why it is it might seem that I'm dismissive about all this bullying stuff and why I think we're coddling too much our children. And actually, why then I think that results in the suicide rate. I'll explain, and I'll get the venom of the expert as well. So here I am, watching my sister walk over to Gulfport East. Now, you got to understand, ladies and gentlemen, she was the only African-American female. Well, there was one other. I think there was a Smith girl. I think she was there, too. Adela's, correct me if I'm wrong. Maybe there was a guy. I don't remember a guy. In the entire school,
one, maybe two, no more than three black folks.
My second oldest sister, Carlos, brave the waters of East Junior High first. I think ninth grade. She may be along with one or two others.
Only ones in the entire school. In this school, that the year before, were being indoctrinated with, we don't, 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate. Those little white boys and girls, in quotes, were scared to be Jesus. They're coming here, Mom, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? What if they breathe on me?
And you had administrators and principals who were very adamant about not letting that happen. It was the courts, ladies and gentlemen. It was the courts that forced them. And I ain't talking ancient history here. You do understand. We're talking about 1966. 67. Actually, didn't really complete and probably until, maybe 1970.
So, you want to talk about bullying?
You go to some place where nobody wants you there. And needless to say, folks, I was taught, just so that some of you Caucasian listeners, and some of you African-Americans who have now taken a page out of the Caucasian parenting book, crazy. You gotta understand, black parents had to decide to send their children into that after watching what was happening in Alabama. George Wallace still on the warpath, not letting Negroes into the University of Alabama. This is right after a little six-year-old girl had to be escorted by marshals in Chalmette, Louisiana. Here we are sitting in the meeting at the KB Hall. Parents talking about, well, who's going to go? Somebody's got to go.
Well, we've got to end it. We've got to integrate this thing, and so...
Well, it's school choice. We can just kind of just go back to Church Street Elementary. Or 33rd.
To which then my dad, well, the bus passes right in front of the school. Why pass in front of the school? You can just go to that school right there. I'm paying my tax dollars to go there like it goes to 33rd. We had no say in the matter, bro. You know why?
Why?
We were children. Children don't deal with grown folks, do they? Better to be seen, not heard, as it should have been. They were responsible for us, and we had the trust that they are going to do right by us. They're going to protect us. Even if we went into the lion's den. No, hang on, Mom. Don't go getting upset with Rip. This is my 12, 13-year-old experience and why I am the way I am. Thank God. It worked. But anyway, so they decide who's going to go. And then it became my turn. And my dad and mom asked me. I went to 7th grade, I was at 33rd, and I was ready to go in 8th grade. I was actually vice president of the Junior School Association at 33rd. I got an opportunity in the 7th grade to go and visit Tougaloo College, Jackson State, and Alcorn. It was a 24-hour thing. They piled up all the 7th, 8th, and 9th graders on the bus, and they was a junior school association. They took you around to the colleges. It was a perfect, wonderful idea. Wonderful idea. That's what black schools were doing then. You see, black schools weren't just sitting there waiting to go to white schools. There were teachers that were brilliant. And they did not allow us to fail. You know why? They used the board on our ass and made sure we didn't fail. Oh, you ain't gonna fail. No. No, you're going to learn this. I wasn't allowed to have a low self-esteem. I just wasn't. I just wasn't allowed. I wasn't allowed to measure myself by the Joneses. That's another word. That's just, you can't keep up with the Joneses. So you're going to play that by the Temptations. In other words, we didn't measure ourselves as to where Caucasians were. Well, you got to understand, in Mississippi, we've always been an integrated society. No, really. However, we've had a feudal system. We've always been around each other, but everybody had to stay in their place. You know, African-Americans go to the balcony at the Paramount Theater and Caucasians at the floor. African-Americans go to the back of the Greyhound bus station, Caucasians goes to the front. In other words, we were around each other, but it was a caste system. It was a feudal system. Well, that was then, and you got to understand that. But it did not mean that African-Americans were going, "Ooh, look at them over there. I can't wait to go over there. Boy, I can't wait. I sure want to go to the bottom." I grew up going to the balcony of most theaters that were segregated and felt very, very proud to do so, except for the bathrooms are very horrible. They never cleaned the black bathrooms. But I knew what was going across the rail there on the floor. I didn't want to sit down there because cold drinks get spilled over there. And I guess Caucasians at the bottom knew not to sit in front of the balcony because they knew the popcorn and all that stuff was going to be flying over there. It was, and they couldn't throw it back up. Look, I'm telling you the truth. But the point is that African, we never measured ourselves as to where you were. My Caucasian listeners, I didn't. Oh, look, they've got a nice brick home. And, I sure wish I lived there. Never wish that. Might admire the house, nice house. But another one's like my house. My daddy made my house. He built it with his own hands, rose a block house right there on Victory Street. Wherever we lived, it was like home, you know? And I think that's what a lot of, actually, Caucasian bigots can't grasp. I love my daddy as much as you love yours. I love my dog as much as you love yours. The problem was is that you think we didn't. You think that somehow or another you, being white, was the envy of the world for us, and it wasn't. We knew you were afraid of us because you saw how you avoided us, you know? You know, it was like, we can't get in the same line with you. And we didn't care. African Americans were not responsible for segregation. The conservatives were. And the bigots, of course, they were one and the same. Still, it's anonymous. We know. So mom, dad, here's where I came from. So, you know, when that bus came down, And it was much louder with my sister. My second older sister got the 2, 4, 6, 8, much louder. But it was still coming from the back. You had this group of ruffians, you know, the ones that hang out at the Billups gas station. It was the 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate. Bus driver didn't intervene, didn't say anything. I was sitting right there behind the bus driver. My mama instructed me. Now, boy, when you get on the bus, they ain't going to like you now. Now, listen to me. This is my parent telling me. Now, just consider this yearbook. And listen to what this black mama is having to tell her black son, in quotes, about getting on a bus with people that don't like it. They ain't gonna like you now. So what I want you to do is sit in the front, and I want you to sit by the window and have your back kind of turned to the window so nobody's behind the back of your head, and I want you to sit right there behind the bus driver. And if possible, you need to try to be the first one off the bus. You do understand, ladies and gentlemen, when I got on the bus, I had a whole seat to myself. But you do know why. Until another black person got on that bus with me. Until Lewis get on the bus with me, nobody's going to sit next to me. Which was fine with me. I'm sure my Caucasian counterparts thought, we'll teach him. Ha, ha, ha. I'm not feeling good, the nigga. Oh, boy, I'll sit 3 in a row on this bus seat before I have to sit with a nigga. All the time, I'm thinking, that's your home, I don't sit next to me. Come on, get on the bus, Lloyd. Have you ever heard anybody talk like this before? It's okay. Because, you know, this is really a study. It really should be a study. Because there's illusions, I think, from Caucasians that somehow another African Americans were somehow disappointed because you weren't accepted. We never, I didn't. You were insignificant in my world. I never bumped into you until I went to school. Outside of that, I was having fun. So we get on the bus, and of course, needless to say, the bus arrives there. We get off the bus, you know, very carefully, not wanting to touch anybody, including the bus driver. Bus driver, he was a one-fingered man. Well, he is a nine-fingered man who never smiled.
I'm sorry, what?
He was a nine-fingered man that never smiled. Not that made a difference. He was a shop teacher, and obviously he had a problem. Sam knows what I'm talking about. I'm being very honest with you, so that you'll understand my perspective before I start taking calls and have you guys go up one side, down the other. Nobody liked me when I got off that bus. When I got to the bathroom, the N-word was everywhere. You couldn't close the stall without seeing that. I mean, it was just, it was commonplace. I couldn't measure myself by what was written on the wall, and now we're talking about a damn book. Everywhere I went, from the Billups gas station to the boys' locker room, this is before they made those panels that you can't write on. I'm talking about in huge markers, sprawled on doors. Nigga, go home. No, really, I'm not making it up. Any one of the first integrating class will tell you that. Ask Terry, you'll tell you. We, our self-esteem was measured by our families. Mom and Daddy. I was expected to go home and get back without ending up like Emmett Till. And if I ended up like Emmett Till, my mama was going to whoop my behind. I was more afraid of that. I was more afraid of that. Boy, don't you go out there and let nothing happen to you. Do you know what it's like for a 12, 13-year-old boy to hear that from his mama and know that she means it? Boy, don't you let nothing happen to you out there. And she doesn't spell it out. It's like, don't you let anything happen. And then, no, say, so if they go do it, they jump off a cliff, you're going to jump off too? They call you dog, you're going to bark? They call you frog, you're going to jump? And don't you cry either. That's where I came from. I don't see a thing wrong with it. Now, I know that someone's going to say it's dysfunctional. Poor thing. Poor Rip. Come. You need a hug.
Okay,
don't you do that.
Okay.
Don't you? You better stay in that office. You better stay in that studio. And why are you wearing gloves? Why are you wearing plastic gloves? I'm over here. Why?
Well, Ro is over here. And
well, why the gloves?
Why not?
Were you going to come over here with those gloves and touch me?
No.
Oh, you know, I know you're not.
Did you want me to?
No, I don't want you to.
Well, why would you ask?
This is going to be a long show. So, anyway, the letter that somehow suggested that I was indifferent, well, I probably am. I probably am. Because, ladies and gentlemen, trust me on this, for coming from where I came from, you got to get over it. You got to get over it quick. And you got to measure yourself. You've got to arm your child with such a great belief in themselves that no one else can shake that. Because if they're measuring themselves by what some knucklehead is calling them, you failed. You have failed. There, I said it. That's your fault. I'll take it when we come back here, folks.
Join